so was love. See your heart of mine, I'm singing, lover, come back to me. You came in last and both had a stay. That day is past, but you're so far away. See your heart of mine, keep singing, lover, come back to me. When I remember every little thing we used to do, I'm so lonely. And I remember every little thing we used to do. No wonder I'm so lonely. The sky was blue and high above. The moon was new, but so was love. And now, see your heart of mine keep singing, love.
Hi, Gary. You guys are muted. Hi, Gary. Cathy, you're still muted.
I am. I was still muted. Zoom. Thank you. He did actually say hello. But...
I hope so.
Let's see. I'm doing what I was supposed to do. I got a little combobulated, miscombobulated.
Well, this is only your 369th time, so everyone understands.
Yeah, I have to edit so that people know who is my guest today. That's something I learned a long time ago. So pretty much this is okay. And did I do that already? Looks good. Okay, ladies and gentlemen. Here we go, save. And now everybody knows what's going on. Ta-da!
Yay, hi.
So now I'm kind of bringing myself back to normalcy. Here we go. Now I'm really here.
Hello.
And Rose is really there. Hi, Roland. Rose is in Chicago. It's so
Hi,
impressive.
Everyone. Very cold here.
Is it?
Mm-hmm. I'm missing LA, but I'm very happy to be here too because I get to sing with some really great musicians this week.
Yeah. That thing that the event that we just watched, you said it was after the pandemic had started, right?
It was post-pandemic, meaning post whatever the worst of it was that, you know, now we're still in. So that was July of this current year. It was the first time that I had performed in a year and a half.
Mm-hmm. How did it feel?
I mean, a lot of emotions. I didn't sing anything sad.
Maybe a good idea.
Yeah, I think for everybody's sake, it was good to just keep it upbeat and fun and tried to be humorous when I could and just tell people how thankful I was that they were there in the audience. And, you know, people were still feeling some trepidation about that. But, you know, the clubs are doing a great job of keeping things distanced and making sure people are doing what they need to do. So, I mean, I'm all for it, you know, open them up, bring people back.
Yeah, I know. You know, I mean, this is kind of a constant conversation, you know, I want to see it keep going. You know, I want to see the places in LA keep going. And I think people are going out. The only reason I go out a lot and then I get tired.
Yeah.
Then I have to wait for a minute, you know, and, you know, I'm in my waiting period right now, but I do go out. I kind of push myself to go out because it's good, you know, it's good to, good to contribute to what's going on and, mm-hmm. you know, in all kinds of ways, right? Emotionally and you know, monetarily and yeah.
Right.
I'm impressed that Catalina's has remained open. I really am.
I know.
So many people came to, you know, contribute to their GoFundMe and pretty amazing.
Thank goodness. There's a club in Chicago like that that is open, I would imagine, because of the donations that came in, and that's called Winter's Jazz Club. And I know that the owner, Scott Stegman, is really thankful because that was a passion project for him. And so, you know, he needed people to chip in and they did. So that club is still going strong. Most of the ones in Chicago still are. So I'm really happy about that. You know, it feels pretty vibrant around here. I think Chicago has come back more so than LA, even though I'm new to LA. I don't really exactly know what the scene is like there, but seems like they're a little slower to come back than Chicago and maybe even New York too.
Well, LA had some closures too. The Blue Whale was a huge venue for LA. It was open seven nights a week and had really great, you know, great musicians, a lot of, you know, the audience is varied, but sometimes you couldn't move in the place. It was so many people. So that was a loss. And he held on almost, I guess, I don't know, could have 9 to 12 months once the pandemic started.
Okay.
That was a big loss. And then Let's see what else. I don't. There are some places that are that just kind of remained open through mm-hmm. Catalina's. Was I mean? Didn't they weren't really in business for a while, but they were holding Sam First and.
Oh right.
This series that Leroy Downs does in Hollywood. Do you know okay. Just Jazz? Have you heard that?
No, I haven't.
That's really like edgy jazz, and Leroy is a DJ, and he has great taste. And he's been doing that. Well, he did it for 2 years before the pandemic, and it's in it's in a photo gallery called Mr. Music Head in Hollywood.
Oh, how cool!
Yeah, and
wow,
it's a great place to go see people, and. They do it every Wednesday, but I'm not sure if they've expanded. I think they've expanded a little bit. And mm-hmm. Anyway, so that place is still going, and I don't know, I'd have to, you know, really think about it, but I think LA's scene probably wasn't the same as Chicago's. I'm guessing. Yeah. How many clubs does Chicago have?
There are a lot of clubs. The main ones are the Green Mill, Andy's, Winters, the Jazz Showcase, you know, they've all stayed open, thank goodness. And there are a lot of other places to play too. A lot of artistic things going on. I'm trying to think if anything in Chicago has closed down the way that the Blue Whale did. I guess I wouldn't know because I haven't been here throughout the pandemic, but you know, one of my favorite gigs in LA since I moved there was yours at the Conference Room.
Oh really?
Back in the summertime. That was so fun. What a fun hang. There were so many musicians there and everybody was sitting in. The weather was perfect. It was outside. Little twinkly lights everywhere. The food was awesome.
It is nice. It is nice. This we did it this weekend and it was Yeah, it was really cold. And I mean, the audience actually was fine because they have the heaters. And somebody even said, I had to take off my coat. But for the band, of course, you know, we were cold and the instruments were wet and my music, you know, all the paper got wet, you know, just by being in, you know, close proximity to the ocean and the coldness. But people still came out. We still had, you know, we still had a nice time. It was really nice. It's interesting about that gig. You know, I've run jam sessions before, like one I had for 16 years. And, you know, I would run out of time, you know, to bring people up, which always kind of hurt me. And then sometimes people are rude to you on top of that.
You know? Even though you're doing your best.
Yeah. It's like, I'm really sorry, but you put him in, you know, in where I should have been. Well, yeah, because I'm running a show. I'm not just, not just like for you. It's for everybody, you know?
Yeah. You're producing a show basically.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But for this gig, it's kind of interesting. We do sometimes go over time a little bit, but, you know, I always seem to be able to squeeze people in, which is great. You know, gets rid of my guilt.
There you go. Whatever you can do.
Oh, yeah. And Roland's mentioning vibrato. Vibrato, which is kind of it's an interesting room. You've sung at vibrato, right?
Yes. Yep. I had the pleasure of singing there last year with a wonderful singer, Elaine Dame.
Oh, yeah.
She had me as her guest. She's one of my closest friends.
At vibrato?
At vibrato. Yep.
Okay. And of course, there's Vitello's too. But so vibrato, the sound is a little interesting for the musicians, I think. You know, it's like mm-hmm. a little challenging. And also on quieter nights, you can actually hear the audience speaking to each other.
Oh, right.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that's, you know, a little weird.
Well, I have a gig there next Wednesday, so
oh.
we'll see what it is like now. But I had the pleasure of singing one tune with Bernie Dressel's band 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
And I thought the sound was amazing, I have to say.
Oh.
Hussein was there running it, and I've never been so comfortable on stage singing. And I don't know what it was, but he just did a great job with it.
Wow.
And I was singing a tune by Nan Schwartz, and she was in the audience. She thought that it sounded great. So I have confidence going into next Wednesday that things will sound good and that I'll feel good on stage. But yeah, it's like you never know, you know, and that's hard when your instrument is your voice.
Yeah, but Hussein has been, like, before he got that gig, he was doing sound. So he's always been connected to sound. And so it's great that he's running it.
He's fantastic.
Yeah. And he's such a great player, too.
No kidding.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, I got to see Tekka there. In July. No, June, maybe.
Yeah.
Julie Kelly asked me to go with her and Barbara. And that was such a great night. I had never seen Tekka. And Hussein was playing with her there.
Oh, cool. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He's, when they were still outside. So maybe it was before June. I can't remember.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. He's a wonderful, wonderful player. And Tekka is really great too.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, anyway. Oh yeah. Roland's, he's mentioning this funny little artist bar that we were playing at called Sunspace that was in Sunland. And I'm pretty sure you hadn't met Brad Dutz, the crazy percussionist. Mm-hmm. So Brad Dutz, he moved this year to up to Washington. And but he's like one of the best percussionists ever. He's really quirky.
Okay.
And so comes up with stuff like, and you're like, wow, that's great. You know, he's been in a lot of my bands because I really like that. But so he was running a Thursday night session at this funky little artist bar. And I mean, funky. each piece of furniture was different from the next, you know, because it was like a secondhand kind of, you know, combination. But anyway, but having said that, Brad had some of the most greatest abstract players come and do that series. I mean, you'd sit in the audience and you'd be going, I can't believe this person, I'm listening to this person in this space, like, you know, it's kind of like your space, you know, it's, know, it's a intimate space, you know, and yeah, so. I really like that kind of stuff. That's fun. Actually, that's one reason I like Japan, because they have so many of that, like small areas, you know, that are
that's cool.
Intimate, you know.
I haven't had the pleasure of visiting there.
If you ever go, you will never stay away, because they will love you.
Oh, thank you. That's sweet.
Yeah, they would flip out over you, I'm sure.
Oh, how nice of you.
Yeah. And I know, because I went through a lot, so I know what goes over, you know, and yeah, you would, and plus they're very loyal. Once you have a relationship with somebody over there, they it's there, you know, it's just there always.
Cool.
Yeah.
Wow.
So, The band that you were using, that was in Chicago that we heard, right?
That was actually Des Moines.
Oh, okay.
And that was the Annie Booth Trio. Annie Booth is out of Denver. So first of all, Des Moines has one of the classiest jazz clubs. Like my top
Des Moines?
Three.
You're kidding.
Des Moines, Iowa has one of my probably top three classiest jazz clubs, in my opinion, that I've ever been to in my whole life.
I'm so surprised. I hate to admit that.
I know.
But
I know.
When I've been to Des Moines, I apparently have been in a different universe.
Yes. Well, altogether, it is sort of a different universe. But several years ago, a couple by the last name of Filippone opened a jazz club, and the general manager is a great jazz singer named Max Wellman, and so he books everybody and runs the place. And he brings people in from all over the country. And the only reason that I know him is because I grew up in Iowa. And so we have a connection that way. But he brings me in a couple of times a year, including New Year's Eve always, to sing at this big event that they have called the Wild Party. It's just super swinging. The Des Moines Big Band, who are just phenomenal, play a huge set that night. People pack it in. It sells out every night or every New Year's Eve.
Wow.
There's, you know, champagne flowing and appetizers, and it's just really swanky. Everybody's dressed to the hilt in flapper attire. And this club is called Noche. It's in Des Moines, and it's one of the most beautiful clubs you'll ever see. It's very dark, classy, somewhat modern, but also a throwback. And it's blue velvet curtains on the stage instead of the red velvet that you might see on an old theater. It's just gorgeous. So I highly recommend anybody that, you know, is kind of taking a tour across the United States or trying to make a pit stop in Chicago, maybe take a detour and go over to Des Moines as well.
Yeah.
Max Wellman, great singer. And does such a beautiful job with this club.
That's pretty cool that the he's a singer and he did that. I can totally relate to that, you know. I've thought so much of opening a place, but I know what I'm good at, and I don't think running an establishment like kitchen and bar stuff, you know.
Yeah.
I don't think I'm great at that. And I watched this thing called Bar Rescue on TV, which is this guy going in and like ripping apart failing bars and getting in people's faces and stuff. And I go, yeah, that would be me probably. He'd probably be screaming at me like, what makes you think you know how to run a bar, you know?
I think you should do it, Cathy. I mean, as long as you have some bar manager that really knows what they're doing, then you don't have to think about that part, you know. You can do all the stuff you love to do.
Yeah, I mean, I've thought of artist spaces. I've also thought of sharing, like a shared artist space, you know, where a number of people pay, and it's more like a concert space, you know. Yeah, so I have thought about that, but it's a big, huge commitment, and you know, there's so many things I can focus on, you know. So,
sure.
But I don't know. Maybe when I get to be 80 or something, maybe then. I think it's time to open a club. Yeah.
Where would you want to do it?
Yeah, well, that's the question. I'd want it to be in an area. Well, I have a thing about parking. So it has to have parking somewhere. And I wouldn't mind taking like an industrial building, something like that.
Yeah.
And there's, you know, there's areas, various areas where you could do that. Shouldn't be too far away from the hub, you know, basically the hub of LA, you know, because you know how people are traveling and, you know, although it'd be nice to be on a public transportation line, wouldn't it?
That's for sure.
Yeah. So. Most of the places I've run and the events I've created have been, I think all of them actually have been in other people's places, you know, either homes or restaurants. I had a really nice place. I don't think Elaine, I thought maybe Elaine had worked there. By the way, she's here. Hi, Elaine.
Oh, yay. Hi, Elaine.
But we were in contact a while back. In fact, that's where I first saw you. I had this place that I was running called Bar Fedora, which I called Saturday Night Jazz Downtown LA, DTLA. So that was in a really nice vegan restaurant downtown across from Disney Hall. And it had parking. And it also It wasn't in the main room. You walked to the back of the restaurant and there was a door. You opened up the door and there was this club. It was really nice. And as a matter of fact, I just posted a bunch of, I loaded pictures up to Dropbox and I posted the link on my Facebook page because I just happened to be thinking about where all those pictures were and I saw them and I was like, oh my God, I should really put these out so people can look, you know? But anyway, so I don't know, have you been responsible for starting events?
Yeah, I mean, when I lived in Chicago, I used to do some jam sessions here and there. I had a long running one at the Jazz Showcase, which is owned by Joe Siegel and Wayne Siegel. And that was really fun. I met a lot of people that way. And it was on and off weekly for a few years. And that was a great time. I loved it. But I can relate to you that it's a lot of work and it is like producing a show because you're trying to please all the people that want to play. And you're also trying to orchestrate who's going to sound good together. And then what the audience is going to want to hear. And also, you know, what to do when something goes awry.
Oh, yes. I remember those moments too.
Awry.
Like the bass player hates the singer and puts his bass down and walks off the stage. And the singer's going, yep. What the fuck?
Yeah. I've had a couple singers walk off stage before. Anyway, you know, it's all just a circus. So you got to make it entertaining.
It's so funny. I mean, some of the stories. Yeah. Well, you and I share that. It's really funny. One time this sax player stood behind the piano player's head. Now, we didn't even really have a stage. It was like part of the dance floor and it was great. It was the best part of the session, 7 years at the Sportsman's Lodge. But anyway, this sax player goes behind like this close, right? And while the piano player is soloing, the guy is playing, he's soloing on his horn or what.
Oh, no.
And the piano player, also a guy with very high tolerance, lost it. He was so pissed, you know, stuff like that. It was just like, hello.
Oh, Lordy.
So when you grew up, were you singing like when you were a kid? Is that how you grew up?
Singing a lot. I was playing a lot of piano. So we were a very musical family. My parents encouraged it. So we were all playing piano, all, you know, singing in choir. And then my siblings sort of drifted away from it eventually, but I kept on with the piano and really got into singing. And I, you know, had to at some point choose between volleyball and voice. And then I had to choose between golf and voice. So I eventually let the sports go, even though I was tall. I chose music eventually over sports when I finally had to. And I was accompanying on the piano for musicals. And then I was singing in the choir and singing for musicals and things, but I had really bad stage fright. So I didn't really come out of my shell vocally until really the end of my high school years and then into my college. And then I decided to major in voice in college. So I had a wonderful, wonderful voice teacher in high school named Valerie Hagener, who I will forever be indebted to because she taught me to love music. And then I went to school at a place called St. Norbert in Wisconsin, where I studied classical voice for 2 years with Michael Rose Wall, who is still a dear mentor of mine. I don't know that he knows it, but I think about what he taught me every day. And then I had a boyfriend at the time who drove me down to Chicago because this was up in Wisconsin. I was going to school. He drove me down to Chicago one day and he drove me past Roosevelt University on Michigan Avenue. And he said, you know, you can study jazz there. I had no idea. I had no idea that you could study jazz as a major at a college because you know, if you grow up in a small town in Iowa, nobody's going to really tell you. That was before there were magazines that were getting thrown at you about, like, you can study anything you want. And so, and that was before jazz education was huge, you know, so none of us knew you could study jazz in college. So he really opened up my eyes. I'm forever indebted to him. His name was Christopher Havlicek. And he told me, you know, if you really want to major in jazz, you can audition here. So then I started on this search halfway through my classical career at my first college. And I decided to audition at the University of the Arts in Philadelphia and then Roosevelt University in Chicago. And my mom went with me on both of the auditions, and I got into both schools. And I ultimately chose Roosevelt because I loved Chicago and I wanted to be closer to my family. So that's when my jazz studies began, back in 1999.
So did Jennifer Barnes teach there at the time?
That's right. Yep, she was my teacher, and she auditioned me. And I remember I had to scat, you know, for my audition, and I just thought, how to do that. But I had, you know, been listening to Ella Fitzgerald for years, so I was just making shit up. So I did my best, and then, you know, thank goodness, and I just adore her. And you know, she's, when I finally got so cool. to school. Yeah,
she's great. And was John Prue there teach
yes, John Prue is accompanist, my elder.
Actually,
so looked up to him.
I met him there too. I was doing a workshop.
Ah.
I don't know what year it was. It was a long time ago. But Jen was, you know, teaching, and I came and I did a workshop, and John was the accompanist.
Oh, how cool!
Yeah. Then he and I, you know, hooked up when he came to LA, and
yeah. And he's done your show.
Yep, he has, and so is she.
Oh, that's cool. Okay, yeah. I need to go back and find hers. I haven't heard that one.
Yeah,
she's lovely. We've had a little bit of a full circle thing. So she auditioned me as soon as I started going to school there, and I got into the top jazz choir. And that really started to change my life, because that's how you really learn your harmony, you know?
Yeah.
She was such an incredible director, because we're learning these really tight harmonies, and she would occasionally just stop and point at somebody and say, what note are you singing? And you can't just say E. You have to say, I'm singing the fifth, or I'm singing the sharp 11 right now, or whatever it may be. So you had to really learn all of that theory, the jazz theory, not just regular theory, but jazz theory. And then when she was teaching these scat in our lessons, a lot of times we would use this method where you start on one note, and then as you go through the changes of a tune, you only change the note up or down by as little as you possibly can when you have to. So you might have to occasionally move up a half step, or maybe down a half step or a whole step, but you stay as much as you can on this one note. And so it teaches you the relationship of the chords and how close they actually are to one another. I can't remember what she called that. She had a term for it.
Said tonal center, something like that?
It was something like that, yeah. And then she also had me, and this is something I forever used with my students for the next 20 years after that, which was, when you're learning how to scat through a tune, you sing the third and the seventh of every tune. So like, or whatever, all the way through, you kind of double up on each one all the way through. And it teaches you to hear the thirds and the sevenths, which are of course most important on every single chord. So, I mean, some of her techniques for learning to hear your way through the changes were just forever life-changing. So she was just, oh my goodness, the most important teacher to me in every way. And then what was really special was that 15 years later, I became the head of the music department at the Chicago Academy for the Arts, which is a private arts high school in downtown Chicago. And she came with her students from UNT to my school to perform for my kids.
How cool.
Yeah, it was really cool. So it was like kind of education, you know, coming full circle.
Yeah.
She and I got to sing a tune together in front of all of our students. We sang Bye Bye Blackbird, and it was just one of the most favorite moments of teaching in my life, because I got to tell all of my students, here's how I learned, here's who I learned from, and this is, you know, all the stuff that I teach you comes from her.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Lovely. Her dad, of course, is, you know, an incredible musician. And I played with him and I just loved it. God, he's just so musical.
Yep, he sure is. You know, when Jen got married to Steve, it was in Chicago, and she asked some of her students to sing at her wedding.
Oh.
And so we got to sing with Bonnie Herman. Are you kidding me? I remember standing next to her and thinking, oh my God, there is an angel standing next to me with the most beautiful voice in the world, and I could barely sing. It was so intimidating. And then I got to sing a duet with Don, her dad. I think it was Unforgettable, if I remember correctly, during the dinner portion.
Oh boy.
And so that was a night I'll never forget. Just so special, so beautiful. And the moment that Jen met Steve, from there on, she was a completely different person. And we all kind of watched her go through the transformation as her students.
Yeah.
She suddenly was just so much happier, so much healthier. And then she needed to leave, you know, she needed to leave and be with him. And we were all so incredibly sad that she was leaving, but it was so obvious that it was the right, perfect, healthy, wonderful choice for her. And she went on her merry way.
Yeah, and she had a daughter who was really musical, of course, mm-hmm. coming from both of them. Yeah, that's really cool. Nice, yeah. Good story. So then when you finished college, what did you do?
Well, I was very confused. Roosevelt was a wonderful school in terms of training to do your craft at a very high level.
Yeah.
To execute your craft.
Uh-huh.
But I didn't have any idea how to get a gig. So that was the one downfall, I would say. It is really, really hard to learn the music business portion of what we do. And so I'll come back to your question, but what I'm getting at is that when I started teaching at the Chicago Academy for the Arts, a big portion of my curriculum each year was to actually teach all of the kids how to get a gig, how to do your taxes, how to network, how to be on stage in a professional situation, all of the stuff that you don't necessarily learn when you're just trying to get ready for a concert in school.
Yeah.
So anyways, I really struggled with that when I graduated. And so I moved back to Iowa at that point because I was kind of burnt out on school. I'd been in it for 5 years and didn't know what to do. Got a job playing piano for some musicals. And so that kind of became my focus for a while. And then I just decided, you know what, I'm ready to just figure this out. So I moved back to Chicago, started networking with musicians, figured out how to start a band, how to get some gigs. And it started very, very slowly snowballing at that point into, okay, here's the scene. Here's how you do this. And here's how to network your way into all of the clubs. Because as we all know, it's not just about, here's my CD, can I please have a gig? You know, or emailing, here's my website, can I please have a gig? So the art of going out every night and networking, you know, became my focus.
Yeah.
And then it just all kind of came from there. So I was in Chicago for 20 years.
Yeah. So, and Frida keeps popping into my head too. Because Frida Lee. So she obviously good friends, you and she, and working singers, I'm sure, you know, right, together.
Yep. We had never done a show together in Chicago, but I hope that we will be able to do one either in Chicago or LA soon, since we now both live out in LA. But I was so happy to find out that she was moving out to LA too, because she moved out there to be closer to her daughter. But also I think she's excited about a new scene. You know, she's been in Chicago for a really long time, and so had I. And, you know, I think at a certain point, if you're starting to do the same things over and over again, start asking yourself, you know, what else?
Yeah.
And coupling that with the weather in California and the beauty of the mountains and the ocean and the newness of everything, to me, I just couldn't stop thinking about it. You know, even though I loved my job in Chicago and I had dear, dear friends, I just had to go.
So did you move out before the pandemic started? Is that like a
just
year
before
or so?
It, yeah, I came out on January 2nd of last year.
Oh, okay. So you actually, but you were, yeah, so you were coming out to visit or to sing or to hang out, but you actually moved. Yep. I see. Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. I was kind of transitioning slowly. I actually had an apartment in Chicago and then an apartment in LA with another woman named Michelle, Carrie Frank's girlfriend.
Oh yeah. Oh my gosh.
And so Carrie hooked me up with Michelle who needed a roommate. And so I was living in both cities for a while. I was going back and forth because I knew that I wanted to move to California, but I wasn't quite ready or sure, or it was just kind of confusing. So I just tried to go back and forth as much as I could until I really figured it out.
Yeah.
And then at a certain point I realized, okay, this is the time. And then I was very lucky that when I moved out here, I immediately got a job with Idlewild Arts Foundation, which is a really incredible organization up in Idlewild, California. And they're a boarding arts high school. So it's very similar to the Chicago Academy for the Arts where I was for 15 years before that. But I'm not teaching anymore. Now I'm doing special events. So I'm the special events manager for the Office of the President.
I thought that was really interesting when I heard that, because as you know, I was a teacher there for a year. And and I just, it was really interesting to me. It was like, oh, they actually kind of, I don't know how to put this, but rose up to looking around for a super qualified person in that particular area. Mm-hmm. Not that I'm totally surprised, because they were, you know, as far as a school environment, I think Idlewild has always been very geared towards the arts instead of administration,
right?
You know, and so I wasn't that surprised, but I guess I was just pleasantly surprised. It was like, oh wow, they actually, you know, stepped up and did what we would have considered would be the best choice, to look around, not you know, right, not just like in their neighborhood, you know, for something.
Yes, right. You know? Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, they are an incredible organization. I'm really happy to be working there.
Is that, so what you do, is that for the high school or is it for a broader community?
It's broader in terms of, I don't run the high school events. I run the events for the Office of the President. So my boss, the president, is Pamela Jordan. I know her from the Chicago Academy for the Arts. She was my boss there for 5 years.
Mm-hmm. Oh my God. I remember when she came. I was there when she came.
Oh, cool. Okay. Yeah. So when she left Chicago, I was, you know, sad because I loved working for her and I always wanted to work for her again. So When I moved out to California, she offered me a job because we were in communication, and I was elated to be able to work for her again. So anyway, I've had a wonderful 2 years working with her. And the main thing that she hired me to do was this festival that happens up in Idlewild every summer called the Jazz in the Pines Festival.
Right, right.
And people come from all over the country to perform at it. Even though it's under the hood of this organization that is primarily a boarding arts high school, the jazz festival that is a fundraiser for them is national or international in some cases. So I had been going out there to sing at it for about 5 years before I moved here. And so I'm very familiar with the format and all the people that play at it and so forth. And so she hired me to run that. And so, of course, I leapt the chance. And then, you know, I took the job and everything shut down. So she moved me into the marketing department, which has been a godsend because I was able to keep my job. But I, you know, was able to use some of my skills as, you know, a social media manager and just general marketing. Also, you know, we were doing some virtual events for the president's office. And now we're back into kind of regular. So summer 2022, the jazz festival is coming back. So now I'm starting to take submissions from musicians again, and we're putting the schedule together. And it's going to be really awesome. We're changing the format. So next year, the Jazz in the Pines Festival is going to be the first 2 weeks of July for an entire 2 weeks.
Oh. So
really fun.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's cool. Well, we'll talk about that stuff afterwards. You know, it's just like little personal stuff, you know, related to that. But sure. That's great. Yeah. And I just being up there is just so nice. It's I was kind of like on the road during that year, which is why I stopped.
Okay.
Because I just didn't feel like being on the road. You know, I was there like 3 days a week, every week, except, you know, on the holidays. But you know, the beautiful thing about it was I even liked the drive because it was a long drive. I could practice, I could talk to people, you know. And then as soon as you start getting up into the mountains, you know, many times I would stop and get out of the car in the middle of the mountain, you know, and just hang out there for 20 minutes or something because of that beautiful, it's kind of a silence, but it's not really silent, right?
Yeah.
But it's beautiful. It's sensuous and it's, it's kind of stimulates your awareness. You know, and
I agree.
Yeah, it's just really, really beautiful up there. So,
and the air is so pristine. You know, to get away from the smog, the fog, and to me, this sounds a little silly, but what I notice when I go up there is that, like, I feel like I'm kind of communicating with the trees. They are so prevalent. Yeah. There's just these giant pine trees everywhere, and all you can hear is the sound that they make.
Yeah.
And so I feel connected to the trees, and I don't even listen to music, you know, I just sort of listen to that sound that you can only hear there. It's a very spiritual place up there, and it's on Native American land, and so they actually teach you to, you know, listen to each bird is sacred. Each animal is sacred. Each tree, each hill is sacred, and listen to what they're saying to you. And that really, I mean, as soon as you drive up there, you feel that without anyone telling you. And then when you find out that it's, you know, Native American land, then it all starts to make sense.
Yeah, I agree. I made little movies of those moments. Sometime I'll share them with you. You know, it's just me like going, listen. You know, it's really nice feeling.
The natural music.
That kind of brings me into, I guess, do you have an underlying spiritual point of view of music or jazz or why you do it?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so very definitely. And it's gone through a bit of a change over the past couple of years. I originally always thought, I'm going to do this to make people happy. I want to sing to make people happy. That was for the first, you know, 30 whatever years of my life. Then at a certain point, I realized the power of all of the other emotions, how important they are too, and how important it is to evoke whatever you can from anyone at any point. I sort of feel like that's my plight in life too, not just singing, but particularly with singing, my whole goal is to make everyone feel, just feel. So before it was to make everyone feel happy, to me now it is most important to make everyone feel anything, you know? It could be intense joy, it could be intense sadness or passion or hurt, remembering something terrible, even, you know, just any emotion, fear, bliss, anything that comes up from a lyric or a melody or a particular note or something the saxophone player is doing or something the piano player just did, or the depth of the bass or a particular rhythm of the drums. Any of that is to make people feel, because I think everything else that we have in the world coming at us right now is numbing us. And so I just want to evoke all of those things from everybody in the audience.
Nice. I like it.
Good.
Let's hear you sing some more.
Okay.
That's a great segue. And let's see. So let me just get my things together. Now there's my jam session.
Yay!
We had such a good time.
Aww,
so some cool. Of these people who there. Yeah, some of the people who are probably on this were there, you know, on this today were there. But here's me on the right and Linda Smith on the left, who runs the Urban Press Winery on Sunday.
Oh yeah, okay.
And a few people who died, this guy and this guy. Mm-hmm. But and Anne Mack, who was a great singer, wonderful singer, and her daughter, she had a daughter who, she had given up for adoption, and this daughter went to find her, and her name is, am I going to remember her name? Oh my gosh, I do know her, but she found her mother, and she had already been singing jazz, and she had heard about her mom, and they hooked up, and Angie Gamble is her name. She's a wonderful singer, and so is Anne. Yeah, it's really interesting. Now, should I continue on this or should I go find something else?
You know, I don't remember what I sang in this set, so I don't know what to tell you.
Well, let's just take a quick peek. I mean,
do that top one if you want to.
The what?
We could do that top one if you want to.
The Metropolitan Room?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
This is a great tune that I learned. Please
welcome to the stage.
From Rose Judy Colella. Garland.
Yeah, definitely.
That's Ben Patterson.
Times, dear, you made me feel so bad.
So give me what I cry for.
Yeah, whoops, wrong way. Oh, that was good.
Thank you.
Yeah, really swinging.
Thank you.
Yeah, Elaine gave you such a nice compliment. She said, so much good stuff is going on when Rose sings. She swings, she digs deep down for those low notes and has a lot of power in the high notes too. Just a great jazz singer, great stage presence too. Classy woman.
Aw, Elaine Dame, I love you.
And Lois Corey says hi.
Oh, hi, Lois. Nice to see you.
And yay. Adam Levine.
Hi, Adam. Aw, how fun. Thanks for being here, you guys.
Adam.
Elaine Dame, I have the pleasure of singing with next week at Andy's Jazz Club in Chicago.
I'm sorry, Adam or?
No, Elaine.
Oh, cool. Yeah, Adam, weren't we going to have you on this show? I think we worked on that for a minute and then I think we dropped it. So come on, Adam, come on on. You and Elaine have probably sung a bunch together, right?
We've sung a bunch together and I absolutely love it. She's a dear, dear friend, one of the sweetest people I know and most loving. And we just have a ball together on stage. So we've done some things together with other singers as sort of a threesome, whether it was with Paul Marinaro or Alyssa Allgood throughout the years. Now we started doing just a duo with a backing band. And so we had a lot of fun last year doing some shows like that right before the pandemic in LA. And then we decided to keep it going. So we're going to do our holiday show next week at Andy's Jazz Club in Chicago. And then in February, some more Valentine's type shows in Chicago in the suburbs. And then I'm hoping that we can get some things in LA for her to do with me too. We just have kind of a fun little banter going on stage. And, you know, we do different types of things individually. When we come together, we like to scat together and get a little sassy. And so it's a lot of fun.
That's cool. Yeah. Yeah, I was wondering while I was watching you singing, do you do other styles of jazz as well? Or is it basically just the straight ahead?
There's a lot of straight ahead, but I also like to do bossa. I like to sing in Portuguese. I like to do a little bit of poppy stuff if it fits, like something that's going to be recognizable to any generation. For instance, I like to do Make You Feel My Love, the Bob Dylan tune, which is, you know, a poppy tune, but it's also something that everybody knows because Adele covered it too. So anybody alive is going to know that song basically, you know, and it breaks up the swing and the straight thing because it's you know, so I think kind of incorporating something like that every once in a while, or a Beatles tune, you know, something to break up the set. So it's not just all straight ahead and standardy, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Cool. Your style is so, it's very enjoyable. There's and you've probably heard this. I bet people have written about this. You're kind of a coquette, but you're sassy too, but it's like, the coquette is like, you know, kind of leads and then and then all of a sudden it's like, oh yeah.
That's funny.
I'm sure writers have written that, haven't they?
Actually, no, I'm glad that's coming across.
Really? That if I was a writer, that would be like, you know, one of the first things I would lead with. Not only, you know, the music part, but that as well. Because, you know, especially listening to a singer, the personality of the person, if they're transparent, you know, is what draws you to them, right?
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, and a lot of the lyrics that we sing are suggestive. They're double entendres.
Yes. You know?
And so you got to figure out a way to play on that.
Yeah.
Because if you don't, they're not going to come across to the audience, or you're going to come across as being prudish, you know, and too sweet. So I think we gotta, you know, the sweet and salty have to even out at some point.
Yeah. Do you do any writing?
Not right now. I mean, I write some lyrics, but not that I want to share with anyone. Mm-hmm. Before, when I was younger.
Do you still play piano?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You play piano pretty well? Is that?
I play pretty well, but I have to look at music. So I'm not going to just sit down and start like improvising.
Right.
It's got to be something that I'm looking at music for. Like a couple of months ago, I was at Winters in Chicago and I played the piano. It was Oscar Peterson's song called Love Ballad, but it's written out. It's not an improvisational piece. So it's this beautiful, almost like a classical melody that I played with Ashley Summers on the bass. So she was bowing the bass and I was playing the piece. That's the kind of thing I like to do. Occasionally I'll accompany myself just playing chords, you know, but I'm not going to take a solo. Mm-hmm. So I got used to accompanying myself when I was, you know, teaching for 15 years and accompanying the singers, you know, so I got pretty comfortable playing chords with both hands and a bass line and such. But, you know, I think we should all do what we're best at. So we do that every once in a while.
Yeah, I play okay. Sometimes people hear me and they go, you play good. And I'm like, I really, you know, my standards of good are not me. I mean, I can play and I can transpose really easily and I can play an intro and an ending. I don't have my bass lines together. But I am going to take a spring course on Fullerton College's site with Jeremy Siskin, because he actually teaches a beginning piano and he's brilliant. And
oh, cool.
Not only is he a brilliant player, but even Otmar Ruiz has commented on his brilliance as an educator. So I'm ready. I'm going to commit to practice the piano.
Yay, I believe in you, Cathy.
Thank you.
One of the reasons why I like to do it is because, you know, the idea of a picture on stage is really important to me. So when you're at a jazz gig and you're in the audience, you're kind of looking at the same picture the whole time. Uh-huh. And in my opinion, you got to mix it up a little bit, you know? So, it's sort of rare for people to move around on the stage at a jazz gig. If there's a singer, then it's maybe a little bit more apparent if they're moving around and kind of like opening up their body to the other musicians during a solo, or if they're like maybe going over and standing next to the piano while the piano player is taking a solo or whatever, that can kind of change the picture.
Yeah.
But I think we need to do more than that. You know, moving around on the stage more to change the picture is really important to me. And even if that means sitting down and playing the piano and somebody else leaves the stage, maybe it's just duo for 5 minutes, you know, it changes the picture. And so people's minds will be more stimulated. You don't go to a play and it's five people standing in the same place for the whole play. You know, that would make me go crazy. Yeah, so I think we need to think more about that as musicians, you know, not only that, but also facial expressions, talking to the audience, all of these things. You got to wake people up, you know, even if you think you sound great, you're not really impressing them as much as you think you are. You're impressing yourself more. So all of these things to spark it up. You
know? That's funny, Rose. Did you happen to see, I can't remember if you were in the audience, Jay Clayton, when she was-
Oh, no. That's the thing that happened where I thought she was at night and she was during the day.
Oh, yeah. Right.
I really wanted to see her. I feel terrible about that.
Oh, yeah. I remember. Yeah, that was, she is, I guess, I'm guessing because she's been an improviser forever, you know, She does what you said, but okay. She does it totally on a natural flow. It's just natural for her to do that, to move around and, you know, and the focus goes with different people. Like she actually did duos with each player, just a duo.
Oh, neat.
And it's great. And well, the musicians, all the musicians said to me, you know, and I noticed it, and I think all of us noticed it in the audience, because I heard a lot of sighs, you know, of pleasure in the audience. Aww. But the thing that she gets up there and her presence, first of all, you feel her experience. You know, you feel that she's a master there just by her walking on stage. And then she has this graciousness for each musician, like a real kind of love, you know, and an eagerness, curiosity of what they can bring to the moment. Mm-hmm. And the players felt that. It was really beautiful.
Good.
Yeah. And she's a really good singer. Her range is great, and she's so spontaneous and, you know, totally connected, you know.
Really cool.
Yeah, it was very nice. And she's 80, you know.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah. Just kind of interesting. Yeah. Do you ever think about how getting older in this career will look?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I do. I mean, especially with, you know, the past couple of years, I mean, drastically changed everything for everybody. And in terms of getting older, I think about my health, you know, and wanting to stay as healthy as I can, because, you know, you think about particularly singers have a harder time sounding great as they get older. And so, you know, I think about just trying to stay in shape and also stay hydrated and practicing and all of the things to try to, you know, remain at the top of my game for as long as I can, but then also realizing when it's time to stop. You know, some people go on a little bit further than they should have, I think, you know.
And yet some people actually seem to get better the older they get.
Yeah. Well, and you know, they say that women's voices don't mature until 35 or so.
Yeah.
You know,
I can believe that. I mean, just looking back, even like at Ella and Sarah and Carmen.
Right.
They sounded best in those periods.
Yep. I think so too. Yeah. So I guess the keeping yourself healthy thing is on the forefront of my mind.
Yeah.
No matter what's happening, which was really hard over the past 2 years, because, you know, I'm sure a lot of people can relate to this, that I just felt like I totally lost my mojo when there was nobody to sing for, no place to sing at, you know, there was live streaming. Nah. I found myself just kind of letting jazz go for a little while, because it couldn't be my focus. And so I tried to put my energies elsewhere. But it kind of taught me a lesson about, you know, if you don't completely focus all the time on the thing that you care about the most, it can start to slip away. And that's sort of what happened. And that was kind of on purpose, because I was really, really sad that I couldn't perform and that I couldn't go see other people perform and that the scene was dead and that we couldn't all get together and hang. you know? And so I even stopped listening to it. I stopped listening to jazz for nearly 2 years because it made me sad to listen to it, because I thought, you know, before, for the first 40 years of my life, anytime I would listen to it, it was like, oh, I want to do this tune. I want to learn this thing, or I want to transcribe this thing, or make this arrangement, or whatever. So when there was no place to share it, to me, there was no point in listening to it. You know, if you can't share it, it was doing nothing for me personally.
Yeah.
So I hope that that starts to come back. I mean, it certainly has come back for me in terms of being excited to perform again and all of that. But the listening to it still a little bit makes me sad. And I don't really tell anybody that. But for it to go away like that was emotionally very difficult. And so I just started listening to other music that I don't perform. And it kind of drifted away for a while there.
Well, I seriously do not think you are alone. I think a huge portion of people, of jazz people, stopped listening for at least 6 months.
Okay. You know,
I remember people saying, I'm just walking by the practice room.
Oh.
I remember that a lot. And I think, I mean, you were very eloquent in how you just said it, you know. And yeah, it's huge loss. That's what it is, you know, especially mm-hmm. for us who really use music as a vehicle to God, you know, to connect to God. I mean, huge loss. And there was kind of reminds me of, I'm trying to think of who it is. You know, I listen to listen and read various spiritual things, you know.
Okay.
Everything from Eckhart Tolle to, you know, and lots of other stuff too. But so there was somebody along the last 2 years especially who definitely said that life is not just all good, you know, right? It's the good and the bad, pain, happiness, you know, all of it is part of the tapestry. It's not just one side, you know. And the more you can have that, you know, then the more content you are, because you understand it's all this experience, you know. Mm-hmm. And it's okay to have this whole experience. You don't have to get mad or hate yourself or, you know, depressed. You don't have to do any of that if you actually understand that fully.
Yes,
you know?
Good point.
And for me, I think I saw that over and over and over again with friends and people I talked to, just exactly what you were saying. You know, you were super sad. You just couldn't be around it because it re-stimulated the loss. You know,
mm-hmm.
and you touched on it also. It in a way it was good too, and not in just one way. I mean, this is a rabbit hole kind of thing, but you know, there's all these different levels of how, why, and how it's good too.
Yes.
You know, it like I said, that's a rabbit hole, isn't it? I mean, there's so many.
Well, I think you should go down it.
Well, I mean, gosh, so there's a loss, and that has so many branches. Just the word loss, the idea of loss for everybody, how we control loss, how we control the manifestation, the effects of loss, all of that, it was really forced into our everyday life, you mm-hmm. know, and we had to look at it. We had to see how we dealt with it. which makes us stronger. Actually, it reminds me, I'm reading a book by Viktor Frankl called The Meaning. I think it's called The Meaning of Life. And it's about he was a prisoner, a Jewish prisoner in the camps, right?
Oh, okay.
What a book. Oh my God. And what I was just talking about is the epitome of what he's talking about. He's talking about for those prisoners who could view their life as a gift and a challenge to deal with the suffering and to do something with it, to make themselves a better person and to rise mm-hmm. above it. It just gives me chills just to think about it.
Wow, cool. Okay.
So I think kind of, you know, I mean, that was quite dramatic. But
that's good. That's good though.
Yeah. But you know, speaking of the pandemic and jazz musicians and such and the loss itself, I think that was one of the benefits of it, was to have the loss just like in your face.
Yeah.
How you dealt with it. Mm-hmm. What came out of it? What and also that, you know, for somebody who's been every single day has music in their life and practicing mm-hmm. and working on it for 50 years, you know, several months of no music, no doing it, you know, it was almost like people were kind of taking a breath, you know, like,
yeah,
oh, okay, right, I remember, I can actually mm-hmm. breathe, I'm a human being without it too, I still am a human being, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just like totally skimming the surface, but.
Well, sure. But I always, along those lines, I always like to ask people, well, what did you do to spend your time on that you had neglected previously? Or what new skill did you adopt, you know? And some people say really interesting things and some people don't. Because they were just depressed, you know? So I acknowledge all of that. But I think it's an interesting question about, you know, how did we all pull up our bootstraps?
Yeah.
And some of us are slower to do that than others. I think I was slower than a lot of people to pull up my bootstraps because it took a real heavy toll on my psyche to not be able to do this. And then it's kind of like, well, then was I unhealthily connected to music if I have trouble when it goes away, you know? But it's like, well, I don't have a husband, I don't have kids, so it's not like I could just like put all my energy into my family because all my family lives far away and I don't have anybody that I live with, you know? So particularly, I think, for single people, it was difficult to know what to do with your time and energy, but then also all the people that do have families and you're all of a sudden in the house with them constantly. Like I met a person recently who was saying, you know, well, what did you do? And I was like, well, I mean, I was really lonely. So I did this and this and this. And he was like, man, I envy you. You were lonely? Wow. So I thought that was actually kind of funny. You know, because I wasn't stuck with seven other people in my house. Kind of awesome, actually.
Which just goes to show you that it really, you know, there are so many examples of this, but it's really about your own personal path. It's not about anybody else's, you know, it's just, that was a lesson that I learned along the years of why I stopped being jealous of my friends and peers who got musical things that I wasn't getting. It's it doesn't matter what it, you can't compare yourself. It's your own personal path. If you're not getting what your friend is getting and you want it, you obviously haven't done what you need to do in your existence to get those things. Also, I have another point of view too, which again is kind of a rabbit hole thing, but which is that I really believe that I create my own reality. And I've thought that way for years. So if you're winning and you're in my universe, I know you. So you're in my universe, you're part of my universe. And if you're winning, I'm winning. Because you're part of my universe. Mm-hmm. I don't have to be doing the exact same things you're doing for me to win, you know?
There you go. That's right, Cathy.
That's right. That was an early realization for me, and I'm really glad. And that's why I could get into community so much here, you know, because I didn't feel competition in, you know, a way that people can feel competition, which is a little more on the evil, evil
side, you know? That's hard to bear when you can sense that in someone.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. let's see. Well, let's listen to something else, I think.
Okay.
And let's see.
Okay, so some of these are live, some of these are live stream.
Oh, look at that.
Huh. Yeah, that was during the pandemic, we were broadcasting through Birdland in New York. Jim Caruso has a show once a week called Cast Party that he used to do live on Monday nights. And then during the pandemic, he did it virtually. And so we broadcasted from LA in Michael Bluestein's studio. He's the pianist.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Should I pick one of those or shall I go?
Yeah, you can do that one if you want to. Give him the ooh la la. This is a Blossom Deary tune. I don't know what made me choose it for this. I was just really into it at the time. And she's one of my favorite singers.
And emerald rings, and you want your man to come through, give him the ooh la la. When your car is asked to stop by a handsome traffic cop, unless you want a ticket or two, give him the ooh la la. If Napoleon had water, your favorite Romeo grabs his hat and starts to go. Don't reveal the fact that you're blue. Don't break down and start to boo-hoo. It's just one thing that you la can la la do la la. Like Tallulah, just give him the ooh la la. If Napoleon, the well-known ooh la la, he'd have changed the history of France. When your favorite Romeo grabs his hat and starts to go, don't reveal the fact that you're blue. Don't break down and start to boo-hoo. There's just one thing for you, la la, to la la do.
Those guys to do that.
You know, that was not, I did not even have to get them to do that. That was Rick's idea, and they were totally happy to do it.
That's hysterical. Oh my god. Cute. Oh my god. That is funny. So did she write that? Did Blossom Deary write that?
You know, I can't remember. I think it might be Cole Porter, if I remember correctly. Does it say below there?
No.
Oh, darn, I should have put that. I think it might be Cole Porter.
Oh, yeah, no, it does, by Cole Porter.
Is it? Yeah. Oh, good, okay, there we go.
That's funny. That was great. That was the piano player at your house from your house the other night.
That's right. Yep. Yeah. Michael Rubenstein.
Strangely, I don't know him that well at all. And you'd think I would.
Good.
You know, just being in here.
He's out on the road all the time with Foreigner, you know, but he's also just this amazing jazz piano player. So
yeah, he's,
you know,
wonderful. And of course, I've known Rick Shaw forever.
Yeah. Yep.
He's a great.
Yeah, and they have a great time playing together. So they're both going to be with me at vibrato on Wednesday, and then Bernie Dressel on the drums.
Oh, cool.
Frank Fontaine is playing the saxophone.
Great.
Yeah, it'll be fun.
Wow. What time do you work until there?
Shows, I think there are 6:30 and 8:15, if I remember correctly.
I have another singer I'm trying to go see, and she's kind of a student of mine, but so the second show is 8:15 vibrato.
I think so.
And 6:30?
I believe so. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm writing it down. You can hear my pen.
Yeah. I know Julie's coming. Julie's coming, all of our buddies.
I'm gonna try and do that. And actually the next night, my I don't know if you knew that I had this seven-piece a cappella vocal improv group called Fish to Birds.
What?
Yeah, it's kind of along the Jay Clayton, Rhiannon. Are you familiar with the jazz, the improviser, jazz singer Rhiannon?
No.
So she, Bobby McFerrin's last group of like a number of singers, eight singers, do you know that group?
I don't know.
Well, it's along those lines, the Bobby McFerrin, Rhiannon, and Jay Clayton, Sheila. It's improvisational. And we've been together about 8 years. So what we do is we just create out of nothing.
Wow. It's just free?
Yeah. It's really fun. And we get, you know,
Oh, that's so cool.
And each singer is a professional individual singer. And some are kind of world travelers, and like Ashley Mars. She's really into Senegal. She's been there a lot, and she's created a lot of music with those musicians. And so just all, it's really fun. Anyway, we're called Fish to Birds because of the Escher drawing where fish kind of morph and change into birds.
Oh, how neat. Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
That's really great.
Yeah, so we're going to do that after your show, and then also, while I'm talking about this, I'll tell people that Saturday, if you're in LA, I have a gig with Larry Koontz and David Pilch at the G-Spot at Alan's house.
Oh, yay.
And that's
the 18th?
Yes. You're gone. Okay. You're gone?
I'm gone, unfortunately, but yeah. I would have loved to have seen that. I haven't been to Alan's place in 2 years.
Really? Oh yeah, because you haven't. See, it's not that I'm not cautious, but I really have gone out a lot. it's just how I am.
Yeah, I'm the same way. I just didn't know that his thing was happening again, you know, on a regular basis.
Yeah, I think he started a little while ago, like 3 or 4 months ago.
That's great. Yeah. It's probably best that now everyone will know.
Yeah.
Rewind.
So what are you doing today there? Do you have a gig?
No, this is my day off. Tomorrow I'll sing for a private party at this really cool club in downtown Chicago called Untitled. Mm-hmm. It's a big holiday party, and so I'm singing for that. And then I'll fly back to LA on Friday morning. And then sing at vibrato on the 15th, and then the next morning I'll fly back to Chicago to sing at Andy's.
Holy moly.
So it's a busy month, but you know, I get to spend Christmas with my family, which is all that matters.
Yeah.
So that's going to be wonderful.
Oh, very nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. I know you're a teacher. Do you teach privately as well?
I don't anymore. I did for 20 years in Chicago, but I would like to be free from that for now.
Okay.
I think I got a little burnt out on it, which is not to say that I didn't completely love it for 20 years, but I don't want to do it anymore.
Yeah. Yeah.
There is a certain emotional component of teaching that became too heavy for me, which I balanced with how much I enjoyed it.
Yeah.
For 20 years and how rewarding it was, but ultimately it was too heavy. Because I've talked to my therapist about this for a long time, and I think that I'm a very empathic person. And so like if somebody is upset or going through something, then I tend to pick it up and bring it in. I have a hard time. And, you know, people in high school and college are going through the worst. And so, you know, going through lesson after lesson every day for all those years, I felt like I was absorbing all of the emotional difficulty and pain and joy of all of my students and them needing something and needing someone to listen to them. I think teaching is therapy, actually. I started to feel like a therapist, which I'm not trained in and which I am too vulnerable towards. So it's just not for me anymore. I loved it immensely. I incredibly love my students that I miss so dearly that I left a couple of years ago. And I love when they come to see me sing when I'm in town, and I will forever be there for them anytime they need anything, but I can't do it as a full-time job anymore.
Yeah.
It's not the right fit emotionally.
I understand that. And that's kind of relating to what we were talking about, you know, the like the underpinnings of what we were going through, you know, when the pandemic started. It's kind of like that. It's for some reason I think more of an accepted perspective in life for success is to stick with something. And so letting go of something that is a long time focus can be difficult, right?
Yeah, for sure. Mm-hmm. Yeah, making a career change is scary.
Yeah. On a smaller, tinier level for me, not at first, but so I had this great jam session. First 7 years was the best. I mean, we had, you would have loved that session.
I know. I wish I could have been there.
Yeah. Great. I mean, sometimes 200 people were in the room, you know, it was just great. But, and it was very open. I kind of ran it like there was no real solid stage. So if people came in and wanted to play, I would just kind of usher them up and, you know, whatever. It was great. But, and then there was like 9 more years of the session moving around from place to place, in which time it degraded into, and I can say this, and people have heard me say this, but it degraded into a mediocre singer session.
Oh.
Which really was not my intention.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Not really not my intention for a jam session, you know, and that's kind of an area to talk about too, you know, but anyway, so at some point it's funny because I have a friend who's always looking for a place for me to start a session, which is actually how I kind of started at the conference room, although I had already found that place. Okay. Okay, thank you. So, yeah, and then I decided, you know what? I think I'm through with the jam, you know, being known as the jam session queen.
There you go.
And then when I stopped, all of a sudden, I really felt like people, I don't know how to put it exactly. It was more of an empathic thing that the viewpoint of me kind of revamped, almost like a reboot, like, oh, she's a singer. You know what I mean?
Oh, interesting. Instead of a hostess.
Yes. And not that I'll ever really stop being a hostess, because I just like that and I'm good at it. But But that, it was that kind of thing. It was kind of, you know, a little harsh, but it was great too. And
there you go.
Yeah. So I do understand about the stopping something that you're doing for a long period of time, that you're good at, that you love on certain levels, you know, but it's just time to move on. And then it's kind of a little shocking.
Yeah. Right. And for other people too, you know, people think of you as being a thing.
Yes.
And if you make a change, it's hard for other people, you know, and I've been in that situation too, where I see someone I know making a big change.
Yes.
And I think, well, what does this mean for all of us? Like, it has nothing to do with us. It's about that person. You know?
Well, that's like when Jen left school, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Yep.
When, and that, of course, brings to mind those of us who have been divorced. You know, when you get a divorce and you've been together a while, you're the people who know that you're married go through a loss.
Yes.
Because, you know, they, your marriage is kind of an extension of their own beingness. And, you know, if you fail or if the marriage fails, then that's part of them too, you know, the failure.
Right. Yeah. And you have to be sensitive about that, you know.
Yeah.
It can't just be about, well, I'm doing this and I'm making this change and it's best for me and everything. I mean, you do have to communicate with the people that you care about, and try to be gentle with them about it, you know, because it does affect their world, whether you think it does or not.
Yeah.
So that's a hard thing to navigate through, because when you yourself are going through such an emotionally difficult time, and maybe it's even financially difficult, maybe it's difficult geographically because you're moving or whatever, it's hard to remember, you know, well, this person and this person and this person and this person, I need to individually explain to them what's going on because I care about them and I know that it affects their world too. That's the hardest thing to do when you're just trying to take care of yourself during such a tumultuous time, you know, and that can make or break a friendship or a family relationship or whatever it may be, you know. So that's a real lesson that nobody teaches you, you know, about how to care for other people when your life gets turned upside down. You know, like somebody needs to write a book called that. How to take care of all of your friends and family when your life gets turned upside down. There's a lot of books about how to take care of yourself.
That's true. That's really good. I like that. I like that a lot. That's great. Yeah. What's one of the best gigs you've ever had? The most fun for you?
One of the most fun is a couple of months ago when I returned to Chicago after having moved to LA. Because as much as I wanted to move out to LA and as much as I love the players out there coming home to sing here for the first time since I moved in since the pandemic was just a love fest. And it was because it was people that I had sung with for 15 years that I finally got to see again, finally got to sing with again. They knew all my tunes, knew all my arrangements, knew exactly what I wanted them all to play. It brought about a sense of normalcy after all that craziness for 2 years. So that was a really heartwarming experience, I'd say. And then also, you know, the one that you played a half hour ago in New York was really exciting for me too, because it was the first time I really had a gig in New York with New York players. And Ben Patterson, the pianist on that gig, is a New York player, but he used to live in Chicago. So we used to play together all the time. So it was like a homecoming with him. So, you know, I have that whole concert on video, and I need to release it song by song. But those are two important shows for me.
Cool. Are there artists who you kind of used as somewhat mentors, you know, whether they were alive or past?
Mm-hmm. I use Ella more than anything for anything I do. So her joy, her scatting, her interpretation of lyric, and also what a lot of people don't carry over from her unless you really dig deep, is all of her banter between songs on her live recordings. I think about that every time I perform, because between songs, she's talking to the audience, she's giggling, she is saying things like, this next song was recorded by so-and-so or written by so-and-so, and I blah, 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 this is my personal connection to it, and I hope you enjoy it. She's always saying, I hope you like this song. I hope you enjoy our version of it. I hope you this, I hope you that. She's making sure that the audience is feeling good, you know? And she's being joyful and laughing. So that is exactly the persona on stage that I want. You know, tell an occasional joke. Interact with your bandmates. Talk to the audience. Don't just go song to song to song to song to song. And I think that goes across any genre, to be honest with you. I had an interesting experience the other night where some friends of mine took me to a concert by Jennifer Hudson and Christina Aguilera. Oh. And I never, ever, ever go to pop concerts. If I've seen either of those singers sing, it's been YouTube or whatever, where they're just going boom, 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 boom. And yeah, there's no real relation to the audience. And what I loved about this concert was that Jennifer Hudson and Christina Aguilera both were extremely personable with the audience. It was at the Forum. So for anybody that doesn't know the Forum in LA, it's a circular, I mean, it looks like it would be a basketball venue or something. I don't know if the Lakers used to play there or what, but it's circular. So you're in the round. So anybody that's on stage has to play to all basically eight corners of the room. So you got to face here, and then you got to figure out how to go over and face here, and then all the other 8 points, you know? And not only were they doing that during their singy dancey parts, but they were also doing that between songs, you know, between every single song, both of those singers would talk to the audience and they would wave and they would react to everyone else waving back at them. I'm so happy that you're here tonight. It's so important to me to be here tonight. And I'm so happy that you all came. This is my favorite song that I'm about to sing to you, or this is from my first album and I haven't sung it in 10 years or whatever. They would tell a story between each song and people went nuts for it. And I think that's so important. You have to, you know, look people in the eye. If even if you've got 3,000 people in the audience, like figuratively look them in the eye, you know?
Yeah.
And talk to them, tell them something personal. Like Jennifer Hudson sat down at the piano at one point and said, I learned how to play the piano so I could play the Aretha Franklin role in respect. And then she played four chords a few times really well and sang for a while on Natural Woman. And then she got up and the other piano player came and took her spot and she sang the rest of the tune standing up. But she told this story about, you know, I learned the piano because of this role. Yeah. People were going crazy.
Yeah.
It's like, we want to know about your life.
Yeah. I saw Lisa Fisher a week ago or so at Catalina's. And so Lisa Fisher was one of the singers in 20 Feet to Stardom. And
oh, okay.
She sang with the Rolling Stones. She's a mother. She is unbelievable. Ooh. She's not like Aretha, but she's like Aretha in that her voice is incredible. Her range, what she can do, she could go from here to here in 1 second, perfect, like beautifully. And she has a trio, just a trio, and I've seen her before. It's guitar, bass, and drums. And they're all really good players. And they treat the music like jazz in the way that they're spontaneous. They have, the arrangements are not just the standard like rock and roll arrangements. They were doing some old rock and roll songs. Like one of her songs is Jumping Jack Flash, but she does it really different. And you really have to know the song to go, oh, wait a minute, that's Jumping Jack Flash. And so she's kind of, and she's funny. She has a great sense of humor. So of course that comes through in her singing too. And she's sexy and sassy and just accomplished. She's really, it's really a great experience to hear her sing and watch her, especially at Catalina's because it's close, you know.
I'm sure.
Yeah, and she definitely had that relationship with the audience that you were speaking of.
You know? It's so important.
Yeah, it really is great. do you, let's see, what is the question I really want to ask about this? I was going to go back to the subject of mediocre singers. You know, I have different tolerance levels for mediocre singers. If they're students and they're really trying and they're putting their heart out, you know, then I actually love it. I almost would like to hear them more than a professional singer. But if I see a mediocre singer who doesn't give a shit, you know, I absolutely lose myself. I'm so angry.
Yeah, I get it.
I was wondering if you have a similar perspective.
Well, I mean, I think mediocre singers at a jam session is one thing, and mediocre singers at a club that we'd all like to be working at is quite another.
Yeah.
you know, I'm going to support anybody at a jam session. I don't care if it goes terribly wrong. If it goes terribly wrong, maybe don't show up for another few months, you know, after you've done the work to figure out what went terribly wrong and taken a bunch more lessons. But if it's your first time and something goes terribly wrong, that's how we all learn, you know, and the jam session is, and it should be open. Hopefully somebody is there to vet whether or not they're ready. So yes, it can be annoying if they get up there and they're completely not ready. But it is also an open invitation, you know, because you could run a jam session where somebody has to be recommended to get up, you know. So most of them are not like that, but that could be the next step towards weeding that out, I guess.
Yeah, those do occur, you know. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I think the thing that bothers me is a lack of responsibility and respect, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. I really don't mind if someone falls on their face, but if their heart is in the right place, you know?
Yeah.
Kind of like reminds me too of when I was running my jam session and I thought it was really interesting. So if a singer got up, even if they were a beginner, if they were aware of the band, then the band sounded great. And the magic was there, even though the singer wasn't maybe right. up to the level of the musicians. But if a singer got up, even if they were really good, but it was more about them than the band actually sounded worse.
Yeah, because they feel disrespected. I mean, how many times do you see a singer come up in a jam session format and they talk to you, they say thank you, and then they just look right at the audience and they start counting off yeah. a tune. And it's like, acknowledge your musicians, you know, introduce yourself. Hi, I'm Rose. Hi, I'm Rose. Yeah. Hello, thank you. You sound great tonight, you know. Let's do this in the key of C, you know, and look at them all in the eye. They're yeah. going to want to play better for you. They're going to want to listen to you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's really, really odd.
Yeah. Yeah. Realities and universes, you know, basically is kind of the subject matter. Yeah. Well, it's actually been 2 hours.
No, it hasn't.
Yes, it has. Unbelievable. We could talk forever, can't we?
We could.
I hope to see you next Wednesday. Thank you so much for spending 2 hours, you know, with us.
Oh my gosh, my pleasure. It was so much fun. Thank you, Cathy. You do such a cool thing with these. I mean, you've had an amazing, amazing group of people on here. So I'm very honored that you asked me to be here.
Well, thank you. And you are, as I said, number 369, which is fabulous.
I want a t-shirt that says that.
That's what I should do. I should like make t-shirts and send them to people. You are
you number 369.
That makes me laugh. This friend of mine who's got a real funny sense of humor. He says, I asked my girlfriend, you know, what number I was for her, you know, thinking, yeah, I'd be like you know, 3 to 5 or something. And she said, you're number 534 on my list of favorites.
Wow.
That's a joke that works for him over and over. Oh, my God.
Oh, my goodness.
So thanks, Rose. I'll stay on after you can say goodbye and sign off, and I'm just gonna you know, blab a little bit more, but you don't have to.
Oh, okay. Well, goodbye, everybody. It's been a pleasure, and thank you for joining us, and thank you so much, Cathy.
Thank you. Have a nice time in Chicago.
Thank you. Take care, everyone.
Bye. My lovely guest, Rose Colella, actually speaking to us from Chicago, although she's living in LA now, but she's going back there to play. So the next 4 days I have archives being posted. You can always go to the page and see one of my interviews. So tomorrow is Stephanie Nikazian. She's a great swinging singer from the East Coast who was married to Hod O'Brien, who was a top bebop pianist, and she also is the mother of Veronica Swift, who's the most up and coming jazz singer, one of the ones who, you know, ever. And so that's tomorrow. And then Friday, through this Noontime hang, I met a really incredible musician from Brazil, pianist, composer, arranger named Benjamin Topkin. And he's really beautiful, wonderful, great. Then Saturday, an old friend of mine who used to live here, who actually was the arranger of at least half of my music on my very first record, Point of View, And his arrangements are timeless. Gorgeous. Rick Helzer. And he's a pianist. He was an educator. He lived in San Diego for a long time and taught at the universities, and a composer and arranger. And he's a little more into the modern style of jazz. And then Rick. And Sunday, a very, extremely creative singer, artist named Eilat Rose Gottlieb. She's from the East Coast, and she is very interesting, extremely creative. So that's really very cool. Let's see what else is happening to next week. The three live people. Monday is Janelle Sadler, who used to live here. She's a really great singer, and she lives in Florida now. And then Tuesday, for you guitar fans, one of the top jazz guitar players alive, Ron Eshte. Wednesday, this guy who I was really connected with about 20 years ago, Tom Lellis. He's a really great singer and very much into Brazilian. And I kind of lost track of him and remembered him for a person to interview. So I'm really looking forward to that next week. And then, as I said, if you're in LA, Rose said she's playing Ed Vibrato on Wednesday, December 15th. December 16th, my vocal improv group, Seven Pieces, a cappella, Create Something Out of Nothing, Swim Deep, Fly High, Fish to Birds. We're going to be at the conference room in Playa Vista, 7 to 9, Thursday, December 16th. And conference room is outside, outside patio, great food, heating lamps. It's going to be really fun. We have a great time. And then Saturday, if you're in LA, if you're into really good quality music that's very natural and fun and deep, I suggest coming to my gig on Saturday, December 18th. It's going to be at a home venue in near downtown LA, with, again, one of the greatest guitar players around, Larry Koontz, and an incredible bass player, David Pilch. And David has been on the road with some very big names. And I used to hear actually Larry and David with Luciana Souza perform, like at the Blue Whale. Just brilliant. I'll never forget this one concert where the room was totally packed, and the three of them were creating beautiful music. So that's next Saturday, the 18th. I'm not ashamed or embarrassed to say that it's going to be beautiful music. So I hope you would come and enjoy it. So have a great rest of your Wednesday. I'm going to decide if I want to go out tonight to see Will Walker at the New Orleans Mardi Gras place in Sherman Oaks. It's an early gig, something like 6:30 to 9:30. That's tonight, really fun. And that's it. Okay, everybody, goodbye.